Hello, everyone. Welcome, welcome, welcome to Between the Lines. Happy Valentine's Day. Whether you celebrate it or not, around the world, happy Valentine's Day, February 14th. You know, welcome. So today's prompt is, what do you do with lemons? Offered to us by our Saiyang artist, Tina K. Boyles Bailey. And Tina, where are you casting from today?
Springfield, Georgia.
Right.
Often a two-light town.
Yes, but you never know where she's going to cast from because she is also, like Lucian, a world traveler. And Lucian, my lovely co-host, can you tell us where you are casting from today?
We are in Penang, Malaysia, where we just came back from the night market and scored a bunch of interesting foods to eat.
Hi, Mom. Hi, Dad. Yes. Diane, I am very sad that we're not in New York eating double fried tofu. And also rather sad that Tina and I have been drooling over the night market food behind Lucian. Yes. It's not just.
I'm just drooling because I'm eating.
Okay. No comment. All right. Moving right along. If you guys had a chance to read Dr. Bailey's bio, well, the most important part is that she actually dares to associate with me. Tina has lived in Bali for the last 26 years. She's now back in the US for a little bit. She has a lot of background in trauma healing. You know, not to say that this group needs it, you know, but that's one of the reasons why Dr. Bailey, Tina, my dear friend, is very qualified to be a Saiyang artist. She's also a multimedia artist. We toured together for many years. It feels like a lifetime together on the road in the first theater company that I was in called The Company, based out of Texas. She is a dancer. She went to SCAD. She's a painter. You know, you name it, she's done it and still doing it. Most of all, she is an artist at heart, and so she loves creativity and enjoys being with creatives. So Dr. Bailey, before we move on, is there anything you would like to tell us more about yourself before we start listening to our artists?
Oh, I'm just delighted to be here. And the biggest thing I can just go, so I have a show going on in Savannah, and it's been a delightful just to see how that's all coming together. And yeah, one day at a time, staying open.
All right. So I want to invite you all to share your poems and responses to Tina's prompt. And I cannot wait to see, you know, what you have created. So, and Rick has raised his hand. The teacher shall call upon Rick Spizak.
Well, thank you and welcome, Tina. Happy Valentine's Day. Happy love to all. I offer you this on the subject of lemons. I call it, oh, lemon, why, wherefore? Lemon meringue pie is one good reason why. A bit in the tea expands for me, and even a dish of fish improves when old brother lemon enters the room. Some might dash for the grapefruit pie. Perhaps someday we'll know the reason why. Cousin key lime will always vie for the fairest piece of citrus pie. I know why, but for heaven's sake, not in your eye. But this alone, I know of this fruit as a garnish. It can astonish many a dish, but up and down, if I get my wish with a slice of pie as large as the sky, old lemon meringue, you can hold the meringue, for which I never cared, especially great glots piled up there. And even if perfection of browning on top, like fluffy clouds with a hint of brown or rose atop, heaven knows, I'll leave you with not a hint of clown in my lemon dish. A very apple of my pie, not cherry or berry to be contrary, but let's clearly not even pumpkin, dearie, which I agree is something. And lemonade, I can hear the long parade of that dear tart, the art of lemon, sends me right straight away to heaven. It's a lovely pie, or I'll know why, and though it said the spy even uses lemon and relied upon a relation and a reagent to the nation.
Oh. And set off by the lemons in the background.
Sweet heart tart.
Tina, you have just met our resident bard, our Shakespearean Rick Spizak. He is also known to put crazy experiments and projects together, which we read Shakespeare on Zoom. Experience not needed. And I'm mad at Rick as well, because he's just made me hungrier. As if my brother and my family wasn't making me hungry enough, I'm now hungrier. Oh. Terrible, naughty people, naughty, naughty, naughty people. Thank you, Rick. All right, who would like to go next? And I would rather not have a food thing. Oh, Ravi, no food, huh? Ravi, are you going to share screen?
Is that visible now?
It's starting to share. There, here it comes.
Okay, Kemlin, you're on mute. Yeah.
Yes, I said, there we go.
Okay. This is a poem which talks about my own growth into the English language. I've used a couple of esoteric phrases here because somebody like me growing up in India grows up between a multitude of languages. I had the dubious history of not having an education in my mother tongue, having been a second generation immigrant into another language space. That language could never be my mother tongue, though it was the only language in which I could transact for a while. And then as a young boy, I started acquiring English in school mostly. And soon it became also the language of communication between buddies because of the school which I entered. And then English language became a language in which I had acquired a little competence that had eluded me in other languages. So here goes the poem. It's called Metamorphosis. I was named after cosmic phenomena. My name Ravi means sun and Chandra means moon, by the way. So I was named after cosmic phenomena, but then who knew such effrontery was a mere veil behind which hid the trepidation of parents too young to know of transgression. Taxonomy is such a lemon of a science that names all that's not and limits the horizon of knowing. Curbed before cribbed, I then floundered in ordained baby suits, Bermuda, flares, denims, then dared the baggies, drowning in ill fits, drifting upon tossing waves of chance, watching the shadow of sun creeping along the floor, waiting for the hour bell to toll before shifting shape. Familial dreams set in compendious prospectus reimagine each singular failure, while nightmares flounce in gaudy dressage. The unraveling of the cocoon can only happen when roiled, jigged then in a fantasy, rebelling from ordaining dreams, gaining a new luster. I get threaded into an unimagined design. All befuddlements then become the early notes of a raucous songster who strove to sing in the nest language. Like one who embraces a new religion, bruises his knee. Then, set on a strange loom, having been spun with incredible care, I get fashioned by my warp and my weft. I grow sheen smooth, spread upon this loom, yet to be imprinted, digital or hand-pressed. I await in all my nudity, no more a lemon, but shape shifted. Thank you.
Thank you, Ravi. Tina, what impressions do you have of this poem? Oh, please unmute.
Oh, yeah, I was trying to get my mouse there. Oh, wow. Yeah, so many visual images, so many questions. I feel like I'm looking, seeing these windows and moments that could be, every one of them could be unpacked. Just the juxtaposition of the name. And yeah, the Chandra and Ravi put together, and what that even came up, and how do you balance the two opposing realities and the youth brought to it. Yeah, I think I'm gonna have to sit with this for a while.
It's
so beautiful.
Like a Dali-esque surrealistic, painting as it emerged, you know?
Yes.
It morphed together. I mean, if Dali had the technology of animation, you know, it would be these images that Ravi brought in and out and in and out and sparkling, just.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. Appreciate that.
Yes, Ravi joined us in my last trip to Penang, so I'm also still very hungry. All right, who would like to go next? I think I want to hear from Diane.
Can you hear me? Yes. Okay. Good morning, good day. Happy Valentine's Day. What do you do with lemons? It's my understanding that too much citrus acid can cause decay. An antidote for foul-mouthed persons? Perhaps without a murderous plotline, just providing them a particularly tart lemonade each day. How quaint. Mumbling curses are humorous and unintelligible. What do you do with lemons? Observe their hue, texture, and smell. Stand still. Consider which fish they will descent and decorate. Consider which tea will grace my special teacup. Look forward to it. Look forward to discover which recipe it will add a touchon of flavor. Consider if its rind will grace my homemade cranberry sauce. or gluten-free tart. So many possibilities. Grow a few seeds, and from start to its finish, from conception through bloom, to have it embellish whatever I choose. Yes, I always have plans for my
And Diane left us hanging.
That was so good. She mic dropped and left.
I know, right? You know, I wanted to go, you know, this is why we need to go back to New York, Lucian, so that we can have the gluten-free tart and the homemade cranberry sauce. Tina.
Oh, I just saw, as I listened to that, everything I kept thinking was dreaming of possibilities, seeing something, and what can it add? Where will it take you? So with every thing that she mentioned, every food, every thought was, how can this add to? What can it become?
And Tina, if you cannot tell, Diane Murray Ward has a theater background as well as a dance background. So.
Oh, she's weaving. Yes. Oh, yeah. Definitely weaving.
And the delivery, my goodness, you know, so sultry, so yes. Tantalizing, seducing us into her kitchen. Mm. Look at her.
There she is. Oh, we were just saying how your words just. We're so weaving, and the possibilities with everything, potential and possibilities are the two words that kept coming out as what can it become? What can it add to? Oh my gosh. So beautiful.
Bravo, Diane. From Diane, let's see, who shall I pick on next? E. Justin, I am enjoying your tantan background. So tell us what you have brought to us today, Justin.
You said no more food, right? So I bring drinks.
Let the party begin. Yeah. All right.
Les allez, bon temps roulé.
Can you see the screen? Yeah.
Yep.
This is when life gives you lemons. Road 9598. Road means like those country songs. I wish drinking songs, actually. So here we go. Adults under constant pressure from Boyle's Law. Off resort to Bailey's alcohol. At 17% pure, it's sure to appease your cortisol. After taking the curtain call, bow out of the drinking hall. But when life gives you lemons, one option is to go into delirium tremens. My faithful story developed a taste, a thirst for Janus-faced waste. Lodge Lamont is what I'm talking about. Flout the stout, reach beyond the doubt. Get a freak out, don't be a sellout. The penultimate passy part out. Lodge Lamont, pack it tight like an old sea dog. Become an eloquent demagogue. Join the tag-along, sin-along. Lodge Lemon, when some sufficiently inebriated, multiple thirst stated, become like Tai Chang, beard stack line, debut, drink wine, C2. Soon you'll be a discerning consumer of Lodge Lemon whiskey, whether you're feeling frisky, risky, or somewhat shifty, eyes growing misty, wondering how the candle in the wind peace. Thank you.
Who
I'll be this. Speechless. That's a lot. Wow. Just the wordplay. And oh my goodness, the meter and the dynamics and the wit and the thoughtfulness and the visual imagery mixed with it. It's phenomenal.
I've really been enjoying, Justin, you've really stepped up, you know, weaving in your imagery and your sense of humor. I'm so glad that you're put in your, you know, Tina used the words weaving. You're actually weaving yourself throughout your poetry in such multi-dimensional ways now, and it's very exciting to watch.
Thank you, Tina. Thank you, Kim.
All right, who should I get to pick on next? I think we need to hear from Ian Mack. Well, we can't hear if he doesn't unmute.
I had a bit of problems with the sound. Unfortunately, I missed Rick's. My court patch is Ravi's, so apologies for being inattentive. I did two, but I obviously only got time to read one, so I'll do the first one that cropped up. It's called What Do You Do With Lemons? What do you do with lemons? Well, you could go suck on one if I was so inclined to be rude or impolite, but there are other more civilized options more to your liking, such as the enticing bite of a wedge of lemon to liven up a gin and tonic, amongst other alcoholic cocktails too. And in the regions around Amalfi, where the terraces are heavy laden with the low-hanging fruit, the liquor of choice, why, it's the jaundiced tint of limoncello that will hit the spot at the back of the throat with a quite convincing brute. And let's show some consideration for all the way they come from the regions of Myanmar and China, and from the slopes of bold Assam. The sharp, bitter tang of citrus adds to many an exotic dish, and even in the mundane English cuisine, it brightens any battered fish. And for all the teetotalers among you, the sparkle of real lemonade with the sharp flip of fresh lemons will slake your thirst like cool mountain dew. But its uses are much more versatile. It answers to almost any call, from relaxing aromatherapy to the cunning spy's invisible ink. It is the heretic of the fruitful world. And so this rare but common fruit, its ellipsoidal dimpled shape, and for all its rough and sour mien, it may even outmatch the majestic grape to make the jaded taste buds sing. Thank you.
Oh, the word that kept coming up to me as you were reading that is diversity, and just thinking, you mentioned the countries and the variety and the added and the rarity and all of this, reminding us that I'm just taken to this place as you read of the paying attention of the subtleties and the difference, and how not all lemons are exactly the same.
A global journey through the culinary as well as in the food and beverages. And I love the sensitivity that you put, that some of us really should not be drinking alcohol, and there's still comfort in a little fruit that can still brighten our spice or remind us.
I'm not one to preach about whether you should indulge in alcohol or not, Kemi. So, you know, don't put words in my mouth, you know, please.
I
could say, like, in my first line, go suck on a lemon. but make sure you've got a bottle of tequila with you.
Oh my,
context is everything.
Okay. What a tasty prompt. Thank you so much, Tina. And thank you, Ian Mack. Next, we have Molly Joseph from Kerala, India.
Hi, friends. Long time meeting you. One thing or other, I couldn't be here. Today, so, so happy to meet this gala gathering. Yes. My little bit on the theme given, what you do with the lemons. Lemons, how I love to squeeze you to extract your sour that penetrates. How I love to squeeze you to extract the sour that penetrates. Energizing, enriching my vitamin potential. You are inextricable from my life of shadow games. Things turn sore, difficult to swallow. Sore they turn, my pitfalls, as I traverse the hills and valleys. But having crossed the caverns, I look back empowered. Lemons, your life energy enthuses. Let me concoct fine mix of sprightly portions with you of hope, freshness. With you, lemons, my energizer of life. Thank you. That's a very short one. Thank you.
Short, powerful, sultry metaphor.
Thank you, Tina. Thank you so much.
I just realized, Tina, you gave our poets lemons, and this is what they are making for you. So cool. Dr. Molly, thank you so much for that that energizing poem about.
Thank you,
Kevin. With lemons.
Thank you.
And just like the little fruit, so much can come out. And the impact in this, just a tart poem. Thank you. All right.
Thank you.
Clive, I don't suppose you have something for us today.
I do, yes. Okay, so you probably know I'm a bit weird anyway, so you probably don't really need telling, but this is a little bit different. So, so what do you do with lemons? As I don't like lemons, and citrus fruits can trigger one of my conditions, my first thought was probably not something you could televise. It's nothing personal. I'm sure there are some nice lemons out there and we shouldn't generalize, but I've never met a nice one. Call me lemonist if you want to. I may start a lemonist movement, but if I had to do something with a lemon, with it being Valentine's Day, I may pretend this is my partner and take it out for a romantic meal. That may sound odd for a lemonist, but surely it couldn't be as sour as my ex. And it's better than nothing. It may even send me a card. I could possibly get the DVD of 12 Angry Men so that he could proudly watch It's Uncle Jack. I don't think that's a romantic movie, but I could stop pretending once we left the restaurant. If he continued to invade my space, I would disguise it as a soccer referee, get it some big games and blackmail it into giving the right decisions. No one would realise it was a lemon. They would just think it had jaundice. The last lemon I got involved with suddenly declared it was actually an elf in disguise. I felt betrayed. It affected me so badly, I went to see a psychiatrist. I was totally triggered when her first words were citrus elf down. But I think the best thing to do with a lemon is treat it as an anagram of the much more agreeable melon. Put up a tent in a field and sing Jack and Diane as a duet. People call that melon camping. Anyway, I'll leave it there. I'll be back in a jiffy. I just feel a bit fruity. Thank you.
Oh my gosh, thank you so much for that. I just feel like I'm about to cry. Oh. I don't know what I can add to that because, oh my goodness, what a perfect way to bring that into beyond the literal fruitness to the situations that we find ourselves in with others and things that we don't want to deal with. Thank you so much.
I did tell you it was different.
It was perfect.
I'm laughing so hard. No, Justin, I might be peeing myself. I can just get it. Oh my goodness. Oh dear. I have to catch a breath for sure. Whew. Thank you so much for that, Clive Osman. All right. I'm looking at my list. And Lantern, did you have something that you wanted to share with us today about lemons? All right. So I am going to read, and then I'll invite my brother to share what he would like to share. And then Tina, you will get a chance to respond with your work. And I will start closing out the show. All right, so what do you do with lemons? Let them fallow. Bounty of lemons, groves yielding excess fruit rot on ground, cadavers decomposing, flesh returning to the earth. Two. Essential oil. Combine in glass bowl 4 to 5 lemon zest, 1 cup coconut oil. Bring water to boil in a saucepan, turn to low. Place glass bowl with zest and oil in saucepan. Infuse for 20 minutes. 5 lemons zested, 1 cup coconut oil. Scent to wake senses. I learned how to make lemonade when I was cast in Steel Magnolias. That scene of me making lemonade in a southern kitchen, talking to my lawyer about how I shot my husband the night before and then was making lemonade and offered him a glass to drink. When I heard about this prompt, was drawn back to that play of how I learned how to make lemonade. And as I did my study on how this young woman in this play, this character, Babe, would be so innocent in delivering her lines about making lemonade from six fresh lemons, a cup of sugar, and water to fill up to the top of the pitcher. And the horrific disassociation of the abuse that she endured from her husband, that she could not even face the reality that she had murdered or attempted to murder her husband. And the irony is, lemon oil is one of the senses that can wake up a person. How do I use the opportunities to wake up? What am I trying to run away from? Stop disassociating. Be present. Wake up.
And thank you so much for that. Vulnerable, open part that so many people can resonate and find themselves in whatever way the story unfolds. Thank you.
Thank you, Tina, and thank you for being here. Lucian.
When I first saw this prompt, I thought I'd be clever and combine my name and lemon and do something about Lululemons, but it kind of got fluffy and fizzled out. So be that, I don't care for Valentine's Day either. Content warning. Bitter lemons served cold. Don't say I love you. Don't say I love you when you don't look at me while I confide in you, beckoning while you swipe your For You page. Don't say I love you when on Valentine's Day you unveil the trophy I won for you, only to inform me I could have bought it on sale with some research. Stab me again by assuring me, no, I do like it. No, really, I do. Then bury it with the other trophies in a drawer rarely opened. Don't say I love you after you chastise me for being selfish, to fall asleep when you want sex after grueling years of terrifying, stressful work, not knowing if I get to keep my job, move again, find our child another school where they might discover acceptance amidst memories of bigoted expulsions. Don't say I love you after you insult who I am and aspire to be, tripping with doubt, questioning my expression. I would rather you find comfort by journeying with me and embracing your inner child. Don't say I love you when you trample me with flippant remarks, condescending looks, eye rolling, dismissing, chiding clicks. You demand I convince you of my truth. I tried, I died, pulverized until I betrayed myself and believed you. Don't say I love you. When you block me from a self-imposed timeout during a heated argument only to bludgeon me with condescending speech that I should trust you and your words and exercise some self-control instead of escaping with a timeout. Don't say I love you until you accumulate enough evidence to underwrite your words. I spent 2 decades earning the right to say I love you, and now I am leaving.
I think the best response to that now is just a little silence of the deep, heartfelt emotion that's contained in all of those words.
I say there's no mention directly of lemons, but there is metaphorically a twist of bitter lemons in there, hidden between the lines there, and some nice, lovely broken imagery, oxymorons. There was one, I can't get the rest of it, but don't trample on something. There was some really nice sort of these kind of paradoxical sort of images, pairings of ideas. So very, gosh, yeah. Really, really powerful.
Lucien, it was flowing out of a wounded heart, insulted, ununderstood, because the wall was too strong between two minds. Yeah, it is so hard-hitting, so soulful, Lucien. Hats off to you.
Thank you so much.
Lucien, I'm going to invite you to play that 3 minutes, and then we'll invite Dr. Bailey to share her bit with us, and then,
take 1 pint of water, add 1/2 pound of sugar, the juice of 8 lemons, the zest of 1/2 lemon. Pour the water from 1 jug, then into the other several times. Strain through a clean napkin. Grandmother, the alchemist, you spun gold out of this hard life, conjured beauty from the things left behind, found healing where it did not live, discovered the antidote in your own kitchen, broke the curse with your own 2 hands. You passed these instructions down to your daughter, who then passed it down to her daughter.
I had my ups and downs, but I always find the inner strength to pull myself up. I was served lemons, but I made lemonade.
My grandma said, nothing real can be threatened. true love brought salvation back into me. With every tear came redemption, and my torturer became my remedy. So we're gonna heal. We're gonna start again. You've brought the orchestra, synchronized swimmers. You're the magician. Pull me back together again the way you cut me in half. Make the woman in doubt disappear. Pull the sorrow from between my legs like silk, knot after knot after knot. The audience applauds, but we can't hear them.
That was an excerpt from Night Falls by Beyonce. Tina, the stage is yours.
First of all, I had never seen that. I've never heard that. And I can't explain how the synchronicity of overlapping, you know, for the past little while. Why did I choose this prompt for everyone? Because this is a prompt that I've been experiencing in my own life. When you get served lemons, what do you do with them? It's maybe not the one you want. Maybe it's like we talked about, the fruit you don't like. But what do you do with it? And so this is something that I wrote in response to the same prompt. What am I doing with my lemons? Trusting the path, even when the light is out. This past year, I've truly felt like I've been walking down a path waiting for the light to come on. Kind of like when you walk outside and even though it's dark outside, but you have those lights that come on when motion is detected. So those few steps are okay in the dark, because in a moment, you trust the lights will detect you and light your path. But what if they do not come on as soon as you expect? Do you stop? Keep going? Or turn around and go back inside the house? What happens next is up to you. For me, the light on my path has taken longer to come on than I anticipated. And at times, I wondered where I should direct my next step, or if I should just rest. And I paused and I waited. Eventually, the light on my path did come on, and the path grew wider and more complete than I could have imagined, but more like a flicker, just enough to help me get my bearings. As I wait, my eyes adjusted to my surroundings, and I can see more clearly. And as each of the next steps on my path are revealed, I'm in a better place. Where are the lights on your path lighting up? Where are they too dim to see, or maybe not even working anymore? Slow down, rest a bit until you can see better. You may be delightfully surprised to see where the next path is leading you.
Someone said that Lucian had mentioned lemons in his poem. Of course it was in the title, but I was thinking about the energy of woods, you know, and some of the woods, the spectrum of energies that woods can carry, which is not necessarily in dictionaries. And sometimes we talk about life giving us lemons, and I felt the latest poem is on point and very, very exquisite and deep and profound at the same time, impactful, engaging, and requiring lots of reflection.
Yeah, I wrote in the chat that lemons offer lessons in life, not just your taste buds. So sometimes we have to go through difficult issues in order to learn something, and hopefully we learn. And if you don't, you're going to taste that again until you get it. So you adjust your lemonade to your taste. You adjust your life to your liking. And I think that's what that means.
Indeed.
Tina, thank you for your poem, for the caring heart that you have brought to this space, your vulnerability, your questioning. There's some in life that sometimes when they see others struggle, they just want to prescribe a quick solution, to plaster a band-aid on our wounds and say, all right, let me kiss your boo-boo and then goodbye. But you leave us with questions, and you offer identification when we go through times of need. Thanks, my friend. Thank you, everyone, for bringing your creativity and your gifts to this space. I would like to thank Tommaso Deep and Namiko and Aaron. I think that Namiko and Aaron are your friends. Thanks for being here. I want to thank Mom and Dad for being here as well. Before we say our goodbyes, I'm happy to share a little special thing for next week. I rarely do this, but I know the talents and the depth of Tina, and she will also be our next shulk artist. And you're in for a treat, because this woman improvs movement and poetry at the same time. But she has the freedom to share what is on her heart. But I know that whatever she brings will be a wonderful surprise. So she'll be offering us another prompt for next week based on what she will be bringing. And I look forward to what she will be asking us to write to next week. So, terima kasih. Now, poets, as we go from the space, I think what this lemon prompt, life will offer us lemons. And depending on how we respond, they can be agents of blessing or to take us down unexpected paths. Even when in Teochew we say, lemons will sop, meaning it will sting the pain of our wounds. But it's actually cleansing and healing. We are valuable. We are lovable. We are capable. of putting this healing salve, even when it's, when it hurts, to grow and to heal. See you next week, my dear friends. Between the lines. Just feel free to post your poems on Club Mermaid, and it's your space, our space. Blessings, everyone.